So we have been discussing about various issues related to unsteady heat conduction, and we will discuss about one final issue about unsteady heat conduction before concluding this chapter, and that issue is about unsteady heat conduction in a semi-infinite medium. So let us discuss what it is. So let us say that you have a medium, solid medium like this, which is also open to this direction, which is x direction. Up to infinity, but it is bounded in the other direction. That means it is not open from minus infinity to infinity, but open from 0 to infinity. So that is why semi-infinite medium. Now question is, like, whenever we discuss some problem conceptually, the first question that should come to your mind is that in engineering, is there anything called as infinity, right? Infinity is something which is a concept which we borrow from mathematics and basic science, but in engineering, can you say that let us make a wall of infinite thickness? So that is not something we do in engineering. However, the term infinite has to be understood from a notation, from a notional point of view, and not from a literal sense. So what do we understand by infinite, or beyond what critical distance it can be treated as infinite although it is finite? That is something which is a matter of importance. So we will see later on that it is not literally infinite, but what it means is that beyond the critical distance, beyond the critical thickness of the wall, the wall thickness can be assumed as infinity. So when is it so? We will try to assess that problem. So just like the other problem, these directions are also infinite. So you have a one dimensional heat conduction along x. So let us write the governing equation. Very similar to the problems of infinite plate, we had this equation. Which property has to be constant for this equation to be satisfied? Yes, k and rho, k, rho and cp, none of the above till k, right? So k has to be constant. Now out of this, out of the other assumptions are that the heat conduction in the y and z directions are not important. That brings you to the one dimensional problem, and you have to keep in mind that we are not considering any heat generation in this particular problem. Okay. Now we will solve this problem. So let us write the initial and the boundary conditions. As we discussed, this kind of problem is called as initial boundary value problem in differential equation, where you also have initial condition and you also have boundary condition. So initial condition at t equal to 0 this is the initial temperature and boundary condition that at x equal to 0, this is x equal to 0, the temperature is T 0 for T greater than 0. So physical situation is there is a block, this block was having an initial temperature, suddenly this wall is subjected to a temperature which is different from the initial temperature, either hotter or colder, and then there will be a temperature change within the block as a function of position and time that we have to find out. Remember that this is not the only possible boundary condition. You could have heat flux boundary condition or there are other possible boundary conditions also. But this we are solving as a representative problem to get the physical insight. But for other types of boundary conditions, the mathematical solution may be different, but the physical insight will be very, very similar. Okay. Now, can you tell what is the most important difference between this problem and the infinite plate problem that we did in the previous class? What is the most important difference? So, if you recall the problem of infinite plate that we did in the previous class, this particular dimension we considered a fixed dimension of L, okay. The entire block was 2L, half of the block was L. Now for this we are not considering any fixed dimension. So if we are not considering any fixed dimension but we are claiming this to be infinite, question is what possible type of dimension it can take for the claim infinite to be valid. To understand that we will do a little bit of order of magnitude analysis or scaling analysis. This term has an order of magnitude of delta t by the time this. What is this? That in terms of order of magnitude, this represents a characteristic change in temperature delta t over a time small delta small t. Okay. Now, what is this? Typically, this is mod of T0 minus Ti. I mean, it depends on which one is higher and which one is lower. But you have the characteristic change in temperature from the initial temperature to the maximum the boundary value which is provided. What is the order of magnitude of this? Alpha delta t by say x reference square. What is x reference? X reference is the distance along x over which the thermal effect is felt. That means let us say you make this wall hot. Let us say initially this block was at a uniform temperature. Now we make this wall hot. If you make this wall hot, there will be a distance up to which this heating at the wall will be felt. Beyond that distance, if I am standing I will not feel that the wall has been heated because the heating effect is not propagating beyond the critical distance. So question is, how much the heating effect is propagated? So now that can be obtained by noting that these two equations, these two terms in the equations, they are balancing, so they must be of the same order. That means if you equate the order of these two, then x reference scales as this delta t, we call as t reference, just the reference time or the characteristic time. Okay. So what does it mean? It means that in this problem, unlike the previous problem, there is no natural physical length scale. The length scale is related to the time scale. This is the new physics that we get in this problem. In the previous problem where we were talking about the infinite plate, the length scale was fixed by the geometrical length L. Now in this particular problem, it is not a fixed geometrical length that is the length scale of the problem. It is a length that depends on time, that at what time you are considering the problem, at that particular time there is a critical length up to which the thermal disturbance at the wall is felt. So that length is square root of alpha into the time that has elapsed. Okay. So that means, so this is a variable length scale, and the variable length scale depends on the time scale. Now non-dimensionally it is possible to define a non-dimensional length. Let us call t ref as t, the local time t, just symbolically. T reference is time when x is local x. Okay. So this is a natural length scale of the problem expressed in a non-dimensional manner. And we will show later on that the solution of this problem uniquely depends on this non-dimensional ratio. That means if you keep this ratio fixed, then the non-dimensional solution is invariant. So we will show that. Now how do we show that? For mathematical analysis, we introduce a variable eta is equal to x into a function of time. Question is, where from our mind this is coming? This is coming from the fact that you see that if this you call as 1 by this you call as gt, 1 by this you call as gt, then this is basically the solution depends on x into a function of time, right? So see how physics guides mathematics. It is, I mean, a mathematician will start with this form of solution, but where from the form of the solution comes? The form of this solution comes from the physical argument that the solution, if it is self similar by itself, then it should depend on x by x reference, that is x by square root of alpha t, and 1 by square root of alpha t you can write as some gt. But the question is that this we already arrived from physical argument that gt is 1 by square root of alpha t or a multiple of 1 by square root of alpha t. But let us say that we do not keep that prejudice in mind. So can we show from mathematics also that gt will be of the same form as 1 by square root of alpha t? Let us try to do that. So whether a similarity solution of this form will, this is called as a similarity parameter. So we seek a solution in terms of the similarity parameter. See, if you are by this time familiar with the method of separation of variables, it will appear to you that this is also a, like a special case of method of separation of variables. Separation of variable is like you can write it in terms of a variable which is a product of function of space into function of time. Here also it is like that, but the function of space is the space variable itself. And the entire solution is a function of this normalized variable. Question is, can we express that or not? That we have to figure out. You can always assume this to be a similarity parameter, but for all problems similarity parameter does not exist. So we have to check mathematically whether the similarity parameter exists or not. So let us see that how we can do that. So if the similarity parameter exists, then the entire solution is a function of the, a single valued function of the similarity parameter. That means it converts essentially the partial differential equation to ordinary differential equation. That means if this is a similarity parameter, then the temperature will be a function of this parameter only. So T will be a function of eta only. So del t is equal to dt d eta, because t is a function of eta only, and del eta del t. Okay, this is chain rule. So what is del eta del t? This is x into g dash. G dash is dg dt from here. So x g dash dt d eta. Then we have to evaluate this term, the right hand side. So del t del x what is del eta del x? Del eta del x is g. So this is g dt d eta. Second derivative of this, so this becomes g square so your governing differential equation, which is this, will become to eliminate one of the variables. So this equation involves three variables, x, t and eta, right? Of course capital T is dependent variable, but I am talking about the independent variables x, t, eta. So to reduce the variables we will substitute x. You can see x is nothing but eta by g. So this you can write as eta by g. So you can write okay. So we have carefully written it in this way because this is a function of eta only, and this is a function of t only, right? So a function of eta only is same as a function of t only, only when it is a constant. So if that be the case, let us isolate this second equation and find out a form for g. So g dash by alpha g cube is equal to c1. So g to the power minus 3 dg is equal to c1 alpha dt, and then you can integrate. So g to the power minus 2 by minus 2 is equal to c1 alpha t plus c2, where c2 is a constant of integration. Now, how can we find out what is the value of C2? Clearly, even if we do not know the exact value, the time dependence should be such that the characteristic length scale, so x by x reference is equal to x into gt. Therefore, x reference will scale with 1 by gt, right? Even if we do not know what is gt, at least we know that x reference should scale with 1 by gt. What is the x reference as time tends to infinity or as time tends to 0? As time tends to 0, what is x reference? X reference is what? X reference is the distance from the wall up to which the thermal effect is felt. At the wall at which the boundary condition is given, what is the distance from that wall up to which the thermal effect is felt? So at time equal to 0, what is that? It is only 0, because only that wall knows that there is a heating. Just the boundary heating has started getting penetrated into the bulk of the medium. So the boundary heating at time equal to 0 is confined still only at the boundary. Therefore, x reference will be tending to 0 as t tends to 0, and gt is 1 by x reference. So gt will be tend to infinity as t tends to 0. So we can say that as t tends to 0,
g tends to infinity, and that means from this equation you must have c2 equal to 0.
So from here you can write that g square is equal to 1 by minus 2 c1 alpha t. So gt so this is something very remarkable, because by mathematical analysis we are getting a form of the gt which is same as we did without any mathematical analysis but just by physical argument, right. So the multiplying factor is not important, because we say that it is of the order of, so multiplying factor may be 1, 2, 3, 4, whatever, but the functional dependence, gt's functional dependence is 1 by square root of alpha t, and that without any deep mathematics, just by physical arguments we could come up with. Now that means that we have come up with a situation when we could separate the function of eta with function of t, and the function of t can be determined. If we could not separate the function of eta with function of t, we say that despite seeking a similarity parameter for the solution, there is no similarity parameter that exists for the solution if we could not separate these two. But because we could separate these two, we can now say that yes, a similarity parameter exists which is of this form x into gt. The next question is that when you have this x into gt, there is a parameter c1 here, so what value of c1 you should take? See, the only constraint is that c1 has to be negative, because this is a real number, and to make it real, because it is negative and alpha is positive and t is positive, c1 has to be negative. So choice of c1 must be negative. Within that, what value of c1 you can take? Any value of c1 you can take, it doesn't matter. Think about the situation. See, the a by b equal to c by d, this is what you have to satisfy. In schools, many problems of ratio proportion we solve where we write a by b equal to c by d equal to k. No matter whatever is the k, k is not a matter of our big concern. Big concern is some, whatever may be the constant, the equality of a by b and c by d has to be maintained. And here also it is the same thing, but the choice of the constant only is to be constrained by a negative constant. So now what we can take any value of the constant, but for simplicity in algebraic manipulation, if you take c1 equal to minus 2, then this 2 comes out of the square root. So as an example, take c1 equal to minus 2, not a must. It is not that it has to be taken as minus 2, it is just one example. It can be shown that whatever value of c1 you take within the negative paradigm, you will finally get the same solution. So it is not important that you have to take this, but if you take this, the only advantage is that you are, the algebraic manipulation gets simpler, because this 2 comes out of the square root. So then gt if you take c1 equal to minus half, then you get square root of alpha t. So that is also possible, but this is an example that we are taking. As a homework, you should take c1 is equal to minus half as another example and show that you converge to the same solution finally.
So if you take C1 is equal to minus 2, then you have d2t d eta 2 by eta dt d eta. This is equal to minus 2 from this equation. Okay. So we basically have to solve this ordinary differential equation, which is quite a simple task. So let us assume dt d eta is equal to f. So that means you have df d eta plus 2 eta f is equal to 0. So you can write df by f plus 2 eta d eta is equal to 0. So ln f plus eta square is equal to ln of c2. Sorry, c3. C2 we have already taken. Ln of C3. Where ln C3 is a constant of integration. So f is equal to C3 into e to the power minus eta square. F is nothing but dt d eta. So you have dt is equal to c3 e to the power minus eta square d eta. So you have t is equal to c3 integral of e to the power minus eta square d eta plus c4. That integral is 0 to eta. Now we will apply the initial condition and the boundary condition to get the two constants. These we have not yet applied. So this is 0 to eta. At x equal to 0, what is t? T is t0. At x equal to 0, what is eta? Eta is also equal to 0. So we can say that at eta equal to 0, t equal to t0. That means c4 is equal to t0. At eta tends to infinity, remember what is eta? Eta is equal to, let us write eta here, eta is equal to x by 2 square root of alpha t. At eta tends to infinity, sorry, as t tends to, rather let us write at t tends to 0, you have eta tends to infinity. That is what I wanted to write, right? As t tends to 0, eta will tend to infinity.
okay. So you can write t equal to ti at that t. So ti is equal to c3 integral 0 to infinity e to the power minus eta square d eta plus t0. Now let us evaluate this integral 0 to infinity e to the power minus eta square d eta. So let us make a substitution. Let eta square is equal to y, okay, just a new variable. So eta is equal to y to the power half d eta . So this will become integral 0 to infinity e to the power minus y into y to the power half minus 1 . What is this integral 0 to infinity e to the power minus x into x to the power n minus 1 dx. It is gamma of half, right? Gamma function of half. So half gamma function of half. Gamma function of half is root pi. So this is root pi by 2. If that be the case, then we can write Ti is equal to C3 root pi by 2 plus T0. So C3 is 2 by root pi into Ti minus T0. So then we can substitute in this equation and write T equal to 2 by root pi Ti minus T0. We have substituted C3 and C4 in this equation. So we can in a compact form write T minus T0 by Ti minus T0 is equal to 2 by root pi integral 0 to eta e to the power minus eta square d eta. By the definition, this is what? This is the error function of eta. Okay? So the error function you must have studied in statistics, where it is a function representing the normal distribution in a statistical sense. Like the probability distribution, the normal probability distribution, which has a Gaussian type of distribution of probability of x as a function of x, that is, that particular form is represented by this error function. So you can also write it in a different way. You can also write t is equal to t 0. Okay, let us subtract 1. This is also called as complementary error function, ERFC. So depending on, so I have shown these two forms because you know different books will give different forms. I do not know which specific book you are following. So it is important to be familiar with the different forms, but I mean this is just good enough to discuss about the solution. Now, this is the mathematical part of the solution, but again let us try to get some physical insight on the solution to this problem. So if you plot t as a function of x, at x equal to 0, t is t 0, then this decays with x. Let us consider another time. This is say time equal to t 1. This is not a straight line. This is my problem. Whenever I want to draw a straight line, I cannot draw it. And whenever I don't want to draw a straight line, it becomes a straight line. This is t equal to t 2 time. So can you tell which time is more, t 1 or t 2? T 2 is more, because intuitively if you allow more time, more and more length of the plate feels the thermal disturbance, right? So this, it comes to the Ti, this is say Ti at some distance x, that means beyond this critical distance x, the wall does not feel the effect of the boundary temperature, heating or cooling, whatever. So when do you consider the wall to be a semi-infinite wall? When the wall thickness is greater than this thickness. So that depends on what is the time at which you are considering. At this time, this is the distance, this is the thickness up to which the thermal disturbance of the boundary is felt. So if the wall thickness is greater than this, that means it is as if infinity. That is the notional meaning of infinity. It doesn't literally mean that it has to be infinity. It has to be greater than the thermal penetration depth, so that other end of the wall doesn't know that there is a boundary at which a temperature has been imposed. Okay. Now, this is a dimensional plot, but you can also make non-dimensional plots. So let us make this plot T minus Ti. This is a plot of 1 minus error function eta. So error function, if you want to make a plot in MATLAB, MATLAB has inbuilt function ERF. So you can use the inbuilt function ERF in MATLAB to plot the error function and to get the value of the error function. Not only that, let us say you know the error function, but you have to find out what is eta. So that means you have to get the inverse of the error function. So for that, MATLAB has inbuilt function ERF INV. So this problem is, if you know eta, what is error function? This problem is, if you know error function eta, what is eta? Because sometimes you have to, you know that this is the temperature. The question is, at what time and position that is the temperature? So then you have to find out basically error function inverse, because you have to get the eta, then you have to do this. See, in old days, you will find that still in books that is there, there is a table of error function. So for given eta, what is the value of the error function eta? That is tabulated, okay. So that is the basically the numerical evaluation of the Gaussian distribution function. So if you have some value of eta from the table, you can find out the error function. Or if you know the error function from the table, you know for what eta that error function is there. But I would say that in modern times, that kind of approach is no more necessary, because you already have MATLAB. You can sit with the MATLAB or any other numerical computation software. If you know the value of eta, just write the corresponding function, type the corresponding function, it will give you back the error function. If you know the error function, just write inverse of that, that will give you the value of the function. You don't have to have a real physical lookup table. That is what you can do, but that's just for implementation purpose. Now you can see, can you tell what is the value of this? What is the value of this point? At eta equal to 0, what is T? T is T 0. So what is the value of this? 1. Typically, if you calculate this, I would request you to plot this using MATLAB. You will see that this value is, I cannot remember exactly, but it will be close to 2. So beyond anything, anything beyond this is like semi infinite. So question is, so that means say x by 2 root alpha t, that is roughly equal to 2 at this point. So which x is considered to be good enough for the plate to be considered to be semi-infinite? It depends on what is the time. Larger and larger time, your plate width also has to be larger and larger to make sure that this assumption is justified. But a very short time, even a small thickness can be infinite. So let us say that you have a laser pulse by which you are treating a material. This is very common in manufacturing processes, very common in surgery, that you have a laser pulse, you are treating with the laser pulse, treating the material. Now, the typically, if you are doing the treatment for a very short period of time, let us say femtosecond for a medical treatment, or maybe milliseconds for a manufacturing process, over that period of time, the penetration depth may be a few micron to millimeter. So in that respect, even a plate with 1 centimeter is like infinity. So again, I am repeating the same concept over and again to make you understand that infinity is not a literal type, literal name that we are giving it here. It is a notional thing. It is that if the thermal penetration depth is shorter than the width, then the width is like infinity. Now let us quickly work out a problem, and then we will call it a day today. Let us say that this is a cold block at 23 degrees centigrade, a cold material block at 23 degrees centigrade. Now you are holding with your palm. That is at 37 degrees centigrade. This may be of two materials. One material is aluminium, the other material is concrete. Out of these two materials, which will feel colder to your hand? That is the question, right? So, out of these two materials, this block can be of these two materials, either aluminium or concrete. You hold it with your hand, which is at 37 degrees centigrade. This is at 23 degrees centigrade, so colder than your hand, but which will feel colder? Now, I do not want to get an answer from you. What I want to get always is how to logically arrive at the answer, not what is the answer. Because, I mean, once you know how to logically arrive at the answer, you can arrive at the answer. But many times, we arrive at the answer with a common sense without knowing that logic, and that is actually very dangerous in science. So, it is important that we know that, or we figure out that how to arrive at the solution. In fact, this is one of the assignment problems of this chapter of unsteady heat conduction that we have given to you. So, how will you know that which feels hotter or colder? Basically, you have to find out in which case the heat flux is more. So, the heat flux this is the boundary, this is basically Ti, and at the boundary this is T0 is equal to 37 degrees centigrade. This is x equal to 0. So, minus k del T del x at x equal to 0. So, what is eta? Remember, eta is equal to x by 2 root alpha t. So, what is dt d eta at eta equal to 0? Look at this expression. Dt d eta is equal to 2 by root pi ti minus t0 into e to the power minus eta square, right? At eta equal to 0, that e to the power minus eta square part will be 1. So, it will be 2 by root pi ti minus t0. So, minus k 2 by root pi into ti minus t0 into del eta del x is 1 by 2 root alpha t. That means, what is alpha? Alpha is k by rho into c, right? So, this will be proportional to square root of k rho c, right? This k divided by the square root of k becomes square root of k, and 1 by square root of rho c becomes square root of rho c, other parameters remaining constant. So, for aluminium and concrete, you have to substitute the corresponding values of k rho c. So, the ratio of heat flux with aluminium by heat flux by concrete is k root over k rho c aluminium by root over k rho c concrete. So, let me write it down here. So, heat flux aluminium by heat flux concrete So you can substitute these values, get the values from this table, and table which is there, table of properties which is there in your book, and figure out that what is the ratio of heat fluxes. Whichever heat flux is higher, that will make you feel colder. Okay, let us stop here today, and in the next class we will discuss about the tutorial problems and the solutions.